You know, I received last week a National Geographic magazine, and the title of the magazine was saying, "World is on the Move." And it has different articles inside, which talk about immigrants, how immigrants constantly moving. And you know, us living in the United States, we think that we are having these immigrants coming from southern borders, and it's all the migration that exists in the world. But that's not all. Lots of migration is going on, and they show in this magazine, they show in different maps and migrational paths of people. People are migrating around in Africa, out of Africa, to Saudi Arabia, and to different continents, and to Europe. And in Northern America, there is an immigration. We have all different reasons for moving. We have different, and all the immigrants in the world, they have different reasons for relocation. And I was thinking a little bit about that subject last week. You know, why people move. I moved quite a few years ago over from another continent. People move in life from place to place, from different places. And in Bible, actually, if we look in Bible, we find it, migration was involved a lot in Bible, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's interesting to me to see all the migration that was happening in Bible. And we can talk about Abraham, we can talk about Israelites, and different people moving to different places for different reasons. And today I hope we can look in our study together and discover not only the main reason for migration, because sometimes you don't have to migrate for this reason, but we'll discover a main reason for our what? Existence. Because migration can help this effort sometimes. Migration can facilitate some efforts in life, or we can be where we are and just implement certain lessons that I hope we'll learn today, and it will help us to be a better suited to serve our Heavenly Father. Because this is our reason, this is the reason why we preach today, this is the reason why we live, I believe, to serve our Heavenly Father. Because He loved us first. Jesus loves us all. Jesus gave His life for us. So we don't just merely exist, but that we have a path, a migrational path, to get to a better place in life here and in life future. Amen? So, today, our scripture reading is found in Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1. Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. What do you think this Bible verse is speaking about? In different translation, like for example in Russian, actually it says, arise, shine, Jerusalem, for thy light is came upon you. So in different translations, it refers to Jerusalem. And reading in the chapter and concept, we can understand that there is a lot of reference to the Jerusalem, to the people of Israel in this chapter. But looking at this Bible verse, I was thinking about how you see, to do something, Jesus always asked to do what? Arise first. So it's some movement, something you need to do first. And then you can shine. And I was looking into the beginning, how things happened in the beginning. Bible says in Genesis chapter 2, in verse 15, and the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to dress it and keep. So where was the first existence of our humanity? The first place where we were placed, Adam and Eve, our parents, it was in the Garden of Eden. And what was their purpose to be in that Garden of Eden? Do you remember? Brother John, I remember, mentioned a couple of weeks ago in his sermon, in the Sabbath school.
Be fruitful and multiply.
And fill up the face of the earth. So for them, it wasn't just a simple command to live in the Garden of Eden, But for them was the command to do what? To grow the Garden of Eden until the whole earth becomes the Garden of Eden. You see, here in this Bible verse, I found original purpose of God for our earth. We didn't want to have high, dry mountains and endless oceans. He wanted our planet to be a paradise, a Garden of Eden. And Adam and Eve were tasked with that job. How did they fulfill their job? Do you remember? They actually did not. Yeah. So they did not fulfill their job. They lost their qualification to be a keeper of Garden of Eden. And as a result of that, they took on migration. Yeah, they were migrants too. They migrated. They migrated not like we have trends right now in our society to a better places. They actually migrated to a worse place. Because the Garden of Eden was the best place on the earth at that time. But because of their sin, the doors were closed for them and they had to migrate into a different place to live. So they were first migrants, Adam and Eve. And there was many migrants after them, we find in the Bible. But I found a commonality. I found a common reason for all these migrations, for migrants, for existence, for relocation, for moving to different places on earth. There was always a different reason. And we can read in the Bible, chapter after chapter, book after book, each story of every hero of Bible talks about their purpose and investment into this original plan of God. But we'll just open one chapter where we find many of these heroes, as we call the chapter of faith, Hebrews 11. But I don't want to talk only about faith found in this chapter, because we heard many sermons about faith of these people. But I want to talk about their expression of faith in Hebrews 11. Have you ever thought about their expression of faith? How that faith would, or in other words, a testimony of these people. Because we love to have testimonies, yeah? We had wonderful testimony of Brother Danny, who just shared a couple Sabbaths ago in our church, and we all enjoyed it. If you have not heard it, you can go on our channel, sdrm.org. On YouTube, you can search for SDRM, on Facebook, you can search for SDRM Denver, and you can hear all those sermons. And different testimony of different people that we actually had in this church. We had young people there and their testimonies, how they were meeting different people on the street. And I believe people who are written in chapter 11 of Hebrews, they had their testimony. Do you believe in that? Yeah. Let's open Hebrews chapter 11. We can look on a couple examples here in the short time that we have allocated this morning. Let's look on the first verse. Who this first verse talks about here? Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So faith itself, it's not only something imaginary, but it's a what? A substance of things not seen. For by it, the elders obtained a good what? Testimony. You see, this chapter talks about, it's not only about their faith or proclamation or things that they believed that nobody could see. There was also involved what? A testimony in their life. So let's look at verse 4, and we will find the first character here to speak about. By faith, who? Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained a witness that he was righteous. So what was the testimony of Abel? A witness. He was a first witness for Christ. You see, his death, his life, his sacrifice, it was a witnessing tool. He was witnessing to his brother at that time. You see how the mission of God that was given to Adam and Eve and Garden of God, we did not stop there. They were to multiply. They were to, so to say, in different words, arise and shine and fill all the earth. And you see the trend is continuous with who? With their son, Abel, their firstborn, their second. Who does what? He's doing testimony. He's witnessing. He's trying to spread the message of the Lord to those who maybe not understand in such a way. And that's a trend we find in all this chapter. You see, all these characters in the Bible, they were doing something to illuminate those around them, to multiply, to be fruitful, to fill up the earth. Let's look at verse 5. By faith, Enoch was taken away that he did not see the dead, and was not found because God has taken him. But before he was taken, he had what? This testimony that he pleased God.
Amen.
Before he was taken, you see, we often like to talk about how he was gone. Disappeared. Nobody could find him anymore. Enoch is gone. But that was not the whole thing. The bigger picture here, and I believe the bigger picture for people who lived around times of Enoch was not his disappearance, but his appearance, his life, his everyday life. Because everyday life of Enoch was what? A testimony that he pleased God. See, people who lived around him, they knew that this man is different. They saw and they witnessed that he was a different Noah. You see, that's an interesting example here. Let's read about Noah in verse 7. Noah, being divinely warned of things yet not seen, moved with a godly fear, prepared an ark for saving of the household, by which he condemned the world. Isn't that interesting? He was a savior and saving and condemning people at the same time. And we can talk about that more, but that's an example of those who accept Jesus and his message, they will be saved. And those who do not, they reject, they will be condemned. And that's what was the testimony of Noah. He was testifying to people by building an ark, by participating in God's plan to save the earth, to transform the earth. And he saved animals, he saved his family. And then we go to the next hero, Abraham. In one word, how can we describe his testimony?
Faith.
Obey. He was faithful to God, obeying every single requirement of God. And we know all his experiences. He says, by faith Abraham, what? Obeyed in verse 8, when he was called to go out in the place which he received as inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. You know, often when we relocate, we're not exactly sure where we're going. Abraham was in your shoes. See, Mike, you may not know exactly what you will meet in Arkansas, yeah? But you have faith that God is leading you there, yes? In our every endeavor in our life, we should go by faith, obeying the word of God. If he said that it would be better for us. And also, he obeyed the command of God when God asked him to what? To sacrifice his own son. So that was the testimony of faithful Abraham. He had faith. And what was his testimony? Obedience to his father. Isaac and Jacob. What was their role? Remember? They had a special blessing. We often read that blessing as something nice, as a poetry. But in those blessings, it was almost prophetic. At the same time, that was the things that they taught their children all their life. You see, when Isaac gave blessing to two of his sons, when Jacob blessed all of his 12 sons, actually he gave 13 blessings. What happened? He actually insisted or repeated one more time the message that was taught to those their kids for all their life. And that's what shaped their reality. That's what shaped their future. That's where they went. And that's what they became. He says, so the testimony in Hebrews 11 of Isaac and Jacob was their blessing. Blessing of their life, not only the word that they spoke on the end of their life, but what they taught and how they teach their kids. Joseph, what was his testimony? He asked for his bonds to be taken out. And that's a short version, but I believe that he was preaching and teaching for all the years of wonderful time in the existence of Egypt. He was telling, we gotta live here. And you know what? Don't even leave my bonds in this land. So it shows his faith and his trust in the Lord. And Moses, he suffered afflictions because he could have been the next Pharaoh in Egypt. But he chose afflictions as a testimony of his faith, that he believed in the future. And we have Rahab here, that she what? She was received. Because she received people, she was received into the kingdom of God. See how interesting, how different testimonies of life of these people. And let's go and look now, what do you think was the testimony that Jesus wanted for his disciples? Remember his prayer? Sing like a blessing of Jacob. They all need it. I was thinking about why did Jesus, and we can also take into consideration ourselves, what is the testimony of my life? We all believe in Jesus. We all call ourselves Christians. We all claim to have a faith. What is the testimony or the expression of my faith in my life? You see, Jesus was praying about his disciples in John chapter 17, verses 21 and 23, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one with us. And the reason for this prayer was the same reason that was from the beginning we found in Genesis. Verse 23 says, that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them, and thou hast loved me. So God still wants to transform our planet into Garden of Eden. He still wants to transform every corner of this planet into paradise. And that was the prayer of Jesus Christ for his disciples. That they may go once I depart and fulfill this promise. But only way to fulfill this promise is for them to be as one. You see, to fulfill the commandment of arising and shining, there is unity needs to be involved in those who are trying to fulfill the purpose of God. The spirit of prophecy says, indeed, in the first disciples was present marked diversity. They were to be the world's first teachers. We just study about teachers in our lesson about Jesus. And disciples were to teach. And they represented widely varied types of character. In order to successfully carry forward the work to which they had been called, this man, different in all natural characteristics and in habits of life, needed to come into the unity of feelings, thoughts, for them to change the world, they had to be on the same page. A unity of feelings, thoughts, and mind. You see, why did the original plan of God fail? He wanted to fill up become the Garden of Eden, to become around the whole earth, and he had two people who were given this work to do. And why that plan failed? They were not united. What happened? They separated. Eve had her own way of doing things. She decided to be, you know what, if I become super friendly to every creature in this garden of the, maybe I'm exaggerating a little bit, but she tried to communicate with everybody and she found her trouble, yeah? There was lack of unity between those two. Why this, their kids, their Cain and Abel, why there was no good relationship? Why didn't work together? Because they were not united. There are different plans for life. What does it mean to be united? It's state of being in a full agreement. A way of combining the parts in a work of art or literature so they seem to belong together. You see, we often read different books and different Bible verses from Bible, but what do we find common on them, about them? They speak about one Savior, Jesus Christ. That's the unity that we find in disciples in their first four testimonies about Jesus. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. They all speak from different perspectives, but they speak about the same Savior. You see, often we look like this when we try to do something. And that's why so many people fail. That's why in Garden of Eden, we're just a pile of what? Carton board. That's it. Paper. Shredded paper. Without unity. But when you have unity, it becomes a different picture. When we are united in Christ, how should we be united? United, Bible teaches us we need to be united in relationships, our feelings, how we feel about each other. We need to be united in doctrine, in our thoughts, and we need to be united in mission or our testimony. What is our testimony? It will be united when our first two things will be united, yes? John 17, 15 through 17 says, I do not ask that you take them out of the world, keep them from the evil one. Jesus continues to pray about disciples. His purpose to be people to be united in relationships is not to separate and become individuals that don't talk to anybody, don't speak with anybody, and don't know anybody. He wanted his disciples to be in the world, but keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. So Jesus wants us to develop relationships in the world. Not with the world, but in the world. How can you develop relationships in the world? Well, by being friendly, to start with. By being friendly to who? Kids to your parents. Parents to be your kids. You become friends. You develop a relationship. You develop a relationship same way with your neighbors, yes? With your friends, with your fellow church members and co-workers. And thus the influence spreads. If you are a friendly person, your influence will spread around the world. The fall of man was filled heaven with sorrow. The Son of God, heaven's glorious commander, was touched with pity for all fallen race. His heart was moved with infinite compassion as the wolves of the lost world rose up before him. But divine love had conceived a plan whereby man might be forgiven. We need to pray for this redemption. How can we? We need to thank the Lord for this plan of salvation. But this plan of salvation became only possible because He had a relationship with us. And that's how we can save those around us when we decide to have a relationship. To the point that I'm ready to give my life for you. That's when you can save people. You see, we studied in the lesson, Jesus spoke with authority. His authority was love. People truly felt that He cared for them. People truly felt that He came not only to the planet Earth, but wherever He went, into Galilee or Jerusalem or different place, people felt that He came to that place just for them. He came to this place to heal me. He came to this place to give me vision. He came to this place to raise me up. That's how Jesus connected with people. Our unity shall be, we shall be connected in doctrine. John 17, 3. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, Jesus Christ, whom you have seen. They may know. This word knowing, it has a deep meaning here. Because by knowing Him, you become like Him. And you make knowing, making known Him to other people. You see? That's how the plan of salvation works. That's how it started from the beginning. God works in the way of replication, replicating character of Himself in those around us, through us. I have manifested your name to people whom you gave me out of the world. Jesus uses Himself as an example. How did He spread the word? By manifestation or testimony. His mission was to save the world around Him. So, in Christ's object lesson, we find the experimental knowledge of God in Jesus Christ, who you've seen, transforms man into image of God. Knowing God is what? Transforming, becoming like Him in His image. It gives to man the mastery of himself, bringing every impulse and passion of the lower nature under the control of the higher power of the mind. It brings him, the last sentence says, into communion with the mind of Him. Knowing God, it means to be connected to Him as one mind. Today, we developed a great ability to search for virtually for almost anything, as we say, on Google. But Google itself is nothing special, but you know what gives power to Google? Connectivity to so many different resources. Google itself doesn't have everything. They doesn't sell everything. They're becoming more and more involved in everything, but they just develop connectivity. They just develop friendship. They develop relationships in the virtual world with every resource that exists there. And now everybody wants to be what? Able that when people search for something, it will become a searchable through Google, because that's how people develop a good business. You see, in the same thing, we can have that connectivity with God Himself and with all the believers from past ages, because right here we have a vast library of experiences and testimonies. That's already our connectivity. And when we have knowledge about God Himself, we become connected to God the Father, to infinite mind. And also, our unity is important in our mission, or our expression of faith in our testimony. What is our mission? What is our reason for existence? What is our reason for relocations in life? Migrations, moving to different places. Is just to get ahead? Is just to make more money? Is it just to be more powerful and influential person? Because if you think about that, it's very shallow reasons. Those reasons are worth nothing. So what is the reason for our existence? What is the reason I live today? You know, to be alive today, just to be born, you already beat lots of odds. For what? What is the reason for my existence? That's why we need to have a mission in our life. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. Our mission is to sanctify the world. Our mission is to come and save what? That which is lost. Thank you so much. Our mission is to save us. Often when we speak about sanctifying the world, we think about preaching. We think about becoming a good preacher. That's not necessarily the approach. Because when you read Luke 19:10, that says, seek and save, for Son of Man is come to seek and save that which was lost. It comes. When you go to see and save something that is lost. You see, I had a lost cat. Well, I have two cats who get often lost. And you know, in order to find them, I have to go where they are. Where they like to hunt, where they like to get lost. And I have to go and look in the hills and places. And you know, ultimately those cats got lost completely. They never came back home because they were always getting lost. So there are two choices for us. We can, in order to find somebody, we can stay at home and pray for God to bring people to church, to my life. Some people pray to bring a person into their life so they can marry that person. People pray to get friends. They pray for what they want. But they don't pray for what they need. They need to pray for God to give them desire to save those people.
Amen.
They need to go out and look for those people. You see, to say lost, you have to go in places where people lost and find them. So it takes deeper involvement of life. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teaching them all to observe all that I have. It seems that the translation says commanded you. But I believe that Jesus, when he was speaking to his disciples, he said, teaching them to observe all that I have showed you, my example. Jesus showed them, he didn't command. And we shouldn't command people, we should show them by our example. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. We're not alone in this transformation. We are transforming the world. We're making this world a paradise. That's the same task that was given to disciples, given to me, I believe. We need to, let's just read underlined words here in this paragraph. We need to reflect. Life and care should be such that through them others will get the right conception of Christ and his service. And only our character and life can be as his, it's when we reflect. When we observe, things will not work. Yeah, because we're just taking everything for myself. If we shine but something of our own, it will not show Jesus Christ. But when in Isaiah, prophet Isaiah says, arise and shine, he means what? Reflect Jesus Christ. Because people of Israel, they tried to shine in many ways by their power and glory, and we know how that ended, yeah? Every time they try to shine by their own strength, they failed. But every time they hid in Christ, they were actually shining because they were reflecting. If we represent Christ, we shall make his service appear attractive as it really is. His service is attractive because that's his life that attracts us. There are many who have given themselves to Christ, yet who see no opportunity of doing any large work. It says it is not necessary that the martyr's self-surrender, which is most acceptable to God. You don't have to die, necessarily, what it says here. It may not be the missionary who has daily faced danger and death that stands highest in heavenly records. It's a Christian who's in private life, in a daily surrender of self, in sincerity of purpose and purity of thought, in meekness under provocation, in faith under piety, in fidelity in that which is at least, the one who in the home life represents the character of Christ, such a one may in the sight of God be more precious than even the world renowned missionary of God. See? So now when we go back to our life, after the church, when we meet new people, is there a reason for us to die? Just to fulfill something in our life? No. Just live your life, your private life, in daily surrender of self. And people will be attracted. You see, there is a Romanian person who decided to be famous at any cost. His name is Stephen Stefan Zygmunt, he wanted to be in Jenny's book, World of Records. And his most recent attempt of making it into that book went in smoke, literally. He made a special attraction that he could smoke 800 cigarettes at once, only to discover after his accomplishment was not accepted because Guinness Book of Records does not accept any more such accomplishments. Smoking 800 cigarettes at once. He didn't give up. See, that's our Christian life. Often we think, I need to do something so special to be written in the Book of Life. At another time, he ate 29 hard-boiled eggs in 4 minutes.
Wow.
But guess what? He discovered that Guinness, they quit promoting gluttony. And he didn't make it in the book as well. He also jumped into the lake from 135-foot cliff, only to find out that his record for diving from a fixed point has already been set at 176. No matter what he could make. But that's our life often. We try to jump, we try to eat right, we try to dress right, we try to do things right, just to discover it's all wrong.
Yeah.
Because we're doing it by ourselves. Not in our learning, not in our position, not in our numbers or entrusted talents, not in the will of man, is to be found a secret of success.
Amen.
Our work can be short, our service can be short and humble. In simple faith we follow Christ. We shall not be disappointed of reward. That which even the greatest and wisest cannot earn, the weakest and the most humble may receive. Heaven's golden gate opens not to the self-exalted. It is not lifted up to the proud in spirit, but the everlasting portals will open wide to the trembling touch of a little child.
Amen.
Isaiah chapter 60, when we go back, it says, arise and shine. I hope today we can understand. How can we be shining? By reflecting. It says, arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, that darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people, but the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. That the Gentiles shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your eyes. Lift up your eyes all around and see. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from afar, and your daughters shall be nursed at your side. Then you shall see and become radiant, and your heart shall swell with joy, because the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you. The wealth of Gentiles shall come to you. The multitude of camels shall come over your land. The dromedaries of Midian and Ephah, all those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and increase, and they shall proclaim the praises of the Lord. You know, there are some people who still understand this literally, as they understood literally in the time of Jesus. And you see, that can be our problem. We often think that God will fulfill things in such a way, the way I understand. There are still people believing that Jerusalem will become the center of this earth. There are still people believe that the Jerusalem will be the richest town and everybody will come and kneel. We don't know the history of the future. But one thing I know for sure, that these words can be experienced of every one of us here. We can reflect the glory of the Lord, and all the riches will be given to us. And of course, the riches, the way we understand, may not be exactly what riches is God giving to us. But we need to accept what God gives to us, not ask for what we want, but ask for what we need. It continues saying, the flock of Kedar shall be gathered together to you, and they shall ascend with acceptance to my on my altar, and I will glorify my house of my glory. And then, verse 10, the sons of foreigners shall build up your walls. It shows the picture in this chapter, it shows the picture that God had in plan from the beginning for God and of me, to make the whole earth a paradise, to make inclusion for everybody that they can come to Christ. The son of foreigners will build up your walls, and their kings shall minister to you, for in my wrath I struck you, but in my favor I have had mercy on you. Therefore, your gates shall be open continually. They shall not be shunned day or night, that man may bring to you the wealth of Gentiles and their kings in procession. You see, in the kingdom of God, there is no migrants and there is no refugees. Because also in the same article in National Geographic, there is a question, why there shall be migrants and refugees? And they try to deal with that. How can be that results if there is no refugees? So people, and the best solution people can come up with, it's not to call somebody refuge or migrant. Does it change anything? If you just change names, it doesn't change anything. But you see, God has a solution for those. There is no migrant and refugees in the kingdom of God. Why? Because we become sons and daughters. And verse 19 of this chapter says, the sun shall no longer be light by the day, nor that for brightness shall be moon given light to you, but the Lord will be to you an everlasting light. Your sun shall no longer go down, nor shall your moon withdraw itself, for the Lord will be your everlasting light. And the days of your mourning shall be ended. Also, your people shall be all righteous. They shall inherit the land forever, the branch of my planting, the work of my hands, that I may be glorified. A little one shall become a thousand, and a small one a strong nation. I, the Lord, will hasten it in its time. Amen.